Nope, we're not doing this. Say you've been to the United States. On a tracker app, you could put that you've been to the US. But what if you've only been to Alabama? You might not want to say that you've been to New York or Washington or Hawaii. When people travel, they usually travel to a certain region, or maybe take a tour of multiple regions, but rarely they visit an entire country. So to better reflect travels, I've created an app to track which first-level administrative divisions that someone has traveled to. So let's start with a definition. First-level administrative divisions are how countries divide themselves up. The US, for example, is divided mostly into states, Cuba into provinces, and Jamaica into parishes. If I'm going to make this app, I first need to gather the proper map data. There are several options to choose from, like this map from Wikipedia, but the data I decided to go with came from Natural Earth, who have created wonderful vector maps of all kinds, including cultural, physical, raster, and others, including for my purposes, that of first-level administrations. Now the data they give is everything I need, but not in the format I want. Ideally, I was hoping for an SVG file that had a path for each region and was labeled as such. But Natural Earth has provided a shapefile, which would probably be better if I knew how to use it properly, but I don't. So I'm going to have to convert it into an SVG file. As a note here, a shapefile is made up of multiple different files, including the SHP, SHX, and DBF files, among others, which all together create the resulting map. But I just used a website called mapshaper.org, and I was able to convert my shapefile into an SVG. But why do I want an SVG? SVG stands for Scalable Vector Graphics. If you open up an SVG file in Notepad or any text editor, you'll see that all it is XML. And the real advantage of SVG is scalability, meaning I can use geometry, circles, squares, lines, and paths, place them as SVG tags, and then draw my SVG at any size imaginable, and it will retain the same smooth look and proportions, in contrast to a JPG or a PNG, which has a definite size that may appear unclear or lose detail when scaled up or down. In the current SGV that I have, I indeed have separate path tags for each region, but the order of the paths is the same as the arbitrary order of the data in the related DBF file, with
Entre Rios, Argentina
being the first entry and
Bergu, Malta
being the last. So very quickly here, I'm going to write a Python script to organize the data in the SVG file to be alphabetically ordered by country and then administrative region, placing
Badakhshan, Afghanistan
first in the list and
Midlands, Zimbabwe
at the end. Interestingly, in this dataset, there are 4,596 first-level administrative divisions, belonging to 253 countries? That seems like more countries than there should be. That's because this data has separated many of the islands from the higher administrations, like the British Overseas Territories or Puerto Rico. So it's not necessarily perfect, but what exactly qualifies as a top-level authority is a messy question already, so I won't be changing what belongs in what category for now. And now I have the SVG file laid out the way I want, with it broken down into groups for each country and the next level administrative regions inside of them. I've attached this new SVG file in the description for anyone who may want to use it for themselves as well. Originally, I was going to develop this program as a native Android app. I began a new app and then uploaded the SVG map, turning it into a vector asset, and then the test compile. Okay, it's a little big. Let's open it up and see what's going on. Huh. So apparently there's a file size limit on these things, and since my map is over 16 megabytes of pure text, Android Studio does not like it. Now, I will admit that this map is very detailed. It is at a scale of 1 to 10 with the Earth. So the easiest solution would be to go to Natural Earth and get a less detailed map then. Maybe not at the scale of 1 to 10, let's try 1 to 50 instead. But where are Africa and Europe? It turns out the only complete map they have with all the administrative divisions is at this 1 to 10 scale option. I did try to simplify it myself, or to put it another way, I tried to use someone else's SVG path simplification tools to simplify the SVG paths, but it turned out a little wonky to say the least. In the end, I think the map was just too detailed to try to change anything. So the workaround is this. I'm going to make what's called a progressive web app. PWAs are installable web apps that are capable of features normally only available to native apps, like push notifications. You may have seen this little install icon on your browser when you use certain web apps online. This lets you install the app on your desktop or mobile device, which to the user looks like any other normal app they installed. So I started this new program the way I normally like to, with nothing. I plan on using JavaScript to modify the fill of the SVG paths when the user marks they visited a certain place, and the easiest way I found to manipulate them is to directly include the SVG right into the HTML file and then get the tag by the ID. but this SVG file is over 4,500 lines long. So for sake of sanity, I added an iframe inside my HTML file and then load in another HTML file which contains the SVG inside of that. This way, I can keep my original HTML page clean and short. Creating a local server to allow cross-origin requests, I began the real work. I started by setting up some functions to make changing colors of areas as easy as saying, I want Florida to be green, and tested that function by coloring all the states in the US a random color. Looks good, except for, oh right, Georgia. It picked up the Georgia ID from Europe first. That makes sense, but wait, Montana? Where is there another Montana? Montana, Bulgaria. Originally, I had it set up where each path's element ID is the exact name of the territory, but if I had a Montana or Georgia with the same name, it was set to the same ID, and the program has no way to distinguish between the two. They look the same to it. So to distinguish them, all I had to do was add a tag to the relevant authority and check both names before changing any colors. And now the US has no gaps in it. With this function, I can easily color each individual country one color, or color each different underlying authority a different color. I then started to work on the UI for how keeping track of the places one visited would look. Here's a mockup with very little CSS that doesn't do much. And then I added in the functionality of changing the region's color. I've added three different buttons here because there are perhaps some places you've only been to the airport of, or driven through, which I would count as a different experience from going to said place. So the region is colored a different color to reflect such. The program must also remember where the user has been to as well, and I'm once again turning to my dear friend, local storage. This time I learned a new trick. Since local storage only stores strings, I can stringify the object I use to track the user's data and then save that. Then when the user opens the page, I can parse the string back into the object, read what was marked, and then turn all the regions the right color again. With so many countries in the world, I also needed a search feature, which was easy enough to implement. I just display anything in the sidebar that matches the user's input and turn off everything else. And after adding another coat of CSS paint to make everything look more professional, I also added a feature where clicking on any territory will display its name on the bottom right. That way you'll know exactly where
Agate is Niger
and
Hargita, Romania
are. And now one of my least favorite parts of any program, the mobile controls. I skipped over this detail before, but I've hijacked the zoom feature on the page so that the same actions one would use to zoom, control plus or control minus and control scroll, zoom in on the map but not the page itself. But most people don't use a keyboard or mouse with their phone, so I have to worry about touches. So I first had to disable mobile zoom on the page, easy enough, one line of HTML. Then the zoom event? Well, there is no zoom event the way there is a click or a key press event, but I did find this Mozilla guide that keeps track of touches and pretty accurately tells when the zoom gesture is being made. However, I found their code as written to sometimes fire a zoom direction in the opposite way that I was gesturing, and it was all due to this line here, which only measures the distance between the x coordinates of the two touches, when it should calculate the distance between the two touches. I've added the proper line in the description down below. Now the website was finished, but it wasn't at the stage of being a progressive web app yet. For that, I needed to add two things. A manifest, which says how I want the app to look and act, and a service worker, which takes care of caching, offline access, notifications, and the like. And of course, I can't forget about a cool site logo for the new app. MapTrack, now available to use online or install on desktop and mobile at nutton.tokyo/maptrack. And if you've made it this far, consider subscribing to the channel for more cool projects. And until next time, thanks for watching.